This is a Palestinian village, okay? So we are not allowed to get in. Here's my town. See? This is the village. Eh, not so far, by a car. You know, it's sensitive.
My mother born in Israel, but her mother, she born in Egypt. I'm basically an Arab, and it's crazy that I can't go to Egypt, you know? My grandmother was born in Egypt, I can't go to Egypt. Or my father born in Iraq, I can't go to Iraq. It's crazy, yeah. You know, I'm not going to stay there, but at least, you know, give me the freedom to go there, to see it, you know?
Of course. That was in my brother's bar mitzvah.
Hayom yom ledet, hayom yom ledet, hayom yom ledet, ha'arat dudu. Yay!
We try not to speak politics because it's difficult, very difficult. One of them is accepted, I'm not accepted. He's not accepted, or my wife not accepted, then he's a warrior.
Yeah, it always, when it involves politics, it always leads to chaos. It usually becomes when choosing who's the right man to do the job in Israel. That's the main discussion. And not everyone is sure who is the right guy to do it in the big chair. If it's Bibi or if it's that guy, you think everyone, this one is shit, this one is an idiot, this one doesn't know what he's talking about, this one wants to take us to hell.
In March 97, a Jordanian soldier shot a group of girls that was here with the school, with a school trip. What we heard in the news, they said that he was a psychopath, but you hear it about a lot of terrorists, so you don't know if they are all psychopaths or it's something that people used to say in the news. So at this time it was real. A guy with a gun came and shot seven girls, so no more games, no more jokes. It was real. And they were almost at the same age like I was, and it's next to my house. But it's also points to think about the peace idea. I believe in the peace idea.
Of course, I believe in no army and no weapons and no one, but in the current situation, if the Israelis put down the weapon, they will not survive long. Just in the last war with Gaza, 4,000 rockets were fired to Israel. And imagine how much fire was fired back to Gaza. So if there is a war situation now and we have a siren, I'm already trained to know that I need to figure out where is the safe zone in my home. So where I'm standing now, this is the safe zone because I have an extra room here and I have an extra room here. That means that I have a lot of walls between me and the street from this side and the same from this side. So if rockets are falling, I'm the safest around here. I'm trained to do it. We have a lot of criticism towards religions and we have a lot of criticism towards politicians. And Orphanland is basically a protest band. A lot of our messages are protest. The fact that we are uniting people turned the band image to be as a peaceful uniting band, which is actually the case in truth. But if you read the lyrics, it's a lot of protest inside and a lot of anger inside and tragedy. From the very beginning in our first album, Sahara, we started to combine motifs from Islam and from Judaism and to be very criticized against holy wars and wars in the name of God, and we always find it to be ridiculous. This place here, it's described as the Holy Land. And if blood is falling on a Holy Land, where's the holiness? I have here a book that I was given by a fan from Jordan. This book, it's called Satanism in Egypt. It's about mostly metal people in the Arab world. And it was written by a Muslim sheikh, a very radical one, I think. And there is a part here on the book that they tell about those metal people and, you know, metal heads. And in this part here, this is a scan of an Orphanland song, Disciples of the Sacred Oath, where we use some parts from the Quran, and I sang in Arabic. We did it in a respected way. I had no intention to provoke or to do something in the face of people. It's a serious text, and it's nothing with disrespect. But the police, it says here that the police found this at this metalhead's house in Egypt, and he was sent to jail for 6 months for the accusation of blasphemy and Satanism. This is a Turkish singer called Zelda. She was a rebellion singer, still is, still alive, and she sang in the late 60s against the government, and I think she was even in jail for a while. And when you listen to this music, the distorted guitar and the oriental riffs, it's like she's a mother of music like Orphanland, the way she used oriental music and rock and roll and rebellion texts. People react very strongly to our music and message because it's an actual message. And they see the results. They see that many people follow us. They see that we unite many people. They see that we unite sometimes even enemies. In 2011, we played in a festival in France. It's called Hellfest. And I got contacted by a Lebanese belly dancer. And she told me that she wants us to wave the flags of Lebanon and Israel on stage. I told her, listen, it's a great idea. For us, it's amazing. We will get a lot of credit for it, but I don't know about you. It might put you in danger. She just said, just bring your flag and let's do it. We did it, and then she had a lot of mess because of that in Lebanon. I think she couldn't go back to Lebanon, and people were searching for her at her grandmother's house.
I was born in a city called Ramat Gan, and at first grade, my parents got divorced and we moved to Bat Yam. And I lived like in front of Kobe. We were neighbors, me and Kobe. This is how we met. We saw each other like on the street, wearing like metal shirts and stuff like this. Mariah Carey, we're the oldest guy in the group. We always not agreeing about stuff that we make, like if it's video clips or lyric stuff or even like art stuff, you know, we always not fight about it, but you know, we are like have really different opinions about stuff like this. But you know, as far as the message, I leave it to Kobe because I trust him and I don't know nothing about it. I don't believe in nothing, actually. Really. I don't think there is a God. I just, you know, want to live the years that have been given to me. I don't need much. Just my apartment and that's it. I really was into like horror movies and you know, comic stuff, superhero stuff, Batman stuff. I was really obsessed with collecting everything. So all the skulls, Bambis and cactus stuff, it's my girlfriend's stuff, it's not mine. She really likes Bambi. I think religion is like something that's supposed to tell you how to act. And the problem is that people, they like read it wrong, you know what I mean? they instead of taking good example and doing good things, they always find the wrong stuff, like, don't do that, this one's good, this one's not good. Religion's supposed to help you see what's right and wrong, and for some reason it always go to the wrong. I wish that it will be like a world without any religion. Seriously, you don't need a religion to be a human being, you know? Look at it, it's like beautiful. The view, the mountains, Jordan over there, the water, it's like oil, salty, and you can float there, very relaxing. There is some mud you can put on. And it's just, you know, it's a quiet area. I love it. I come here like twice or three times a year. I guess all of us not really like a party people. For me, it's really pretty much staying at home, listening to music, and from time to time coming here. Here, it's the cover of our last album. And it's like a combination of Star of David, the Islamic symbol and the cross. And I believe that we are all one, actually. We're all the same. It doesn't matter like if you're from Jordan, you're from Egypt over there, or from here. We are all one, and I really like the idea of this one. You know, Israel, for me, it's... I don't like borders, you know? If there were not borders here, you know, it's gonna be like bloodbath, I think.
My grandparents came from Iraq. When I came here, it was 1994. The border was hot back then. I remember as a kid that sometimes we had like a message at the phones, or the officer of the place was telling us, okay, please stay in the house, and all the guys need to go out with gun. And my father used to have a gun at the house. Every house has to have one gun. Since then it became fine. I see myself kind of a black sheep in this place. In my area, there are not so many metalheads, metal people. In entire Israel, they are, you know, hiding in their houses. So I was so different than the other people, you know. And also the reason that I always stayed in the house, because I wanted to practice the drums, and always my friends used to ask me, why you don't go and play with us? Why you don't go and meet with us? And I just had to do what I need to do.
In Colombia, it was a show of the band. I have a friend. He is the producer of the band, so he invited me to come to the show. So I saw Matan, and it was like, love immediately. I finished my university. I said, okay, Pa, I want to go to live to Israel with my boyfriend. I'm sure about it. And he told me, no, please, no, stay here. And I said, yes. And he said, tell me about him. I said, he's an Arabic Jewish. He's half Kurdish, half from Iraq. And he just told me, no, he gonna hit you. They're really sure I need to cover and go on the street, like kind of Arabic. And I said, no, really, no, I can be free. I can dress wherever I want to dress. And it was so funny for all my family. Actually, my father is still asking me all the time, how is living in Israel? And I told him, look, we have bunker in our home. This is our bunker. You know, we are close to Syria. We are We are knowing, you know. When I came here, I said, why we have this weird place? What is this? And he said, it's a bunker. And he said, what we need to have in our house? A bunker is crazy. And he said, no, it's something that all the Israeli houses need to have in their home. It's about security. It's very, very important to have one. You never know what happened. And this is Israeli life. You never know what could happen.
Shabbat is the holiest day of the week. We walk all the day for the Shabbat, and the Jewish tradition we compare the Shabbat with the wife. This is how we do it. So this is why we sing this song of five minutes singing.
Yeah, blessing me.
About all the things that the wife can do, and that she's the best, and she's the house. I'm not religious. Most of my family are traditional. I'm also consider myself as a traditional Jewish guy. I'm not eating Schwein. I'm not mixing dairy product with meat. I don't see myself part of, you know, the actual religion, to go to synagogue and pray and practice. This is something that it's very hard for me to do. It's just, I do it with the music. This is my practice.
Basically my room. I tend to sleep here more than I sleep in my bedroom. Here I just usually write all my stuff. I wrote two Orphanland albums here in this place, made like all those nice demos. It's amazing to think that all of whatever is happening out there and spreading out there, whatever I wanted it to be, happened in such a small location and very humble location. I would say that people are all born different, but I believe that you can shape everyone. It depends on what the world shows you. If you are shown one thing forever, that's the only life you'll know, because that's what people brainwashed you to. Educate, brainwash. There's a fine line between those. When it comes to religion, I would say it's lots of brainwash. It's not a matter of teaching. It's enforcing something that is not my opinion and making me believe that this is real. I believe that trauma is the one thing that can shape a whole person. Whether he was the happiest person, it can make him the saddest person in 1 second. The Arabic people, the Palestinians, the guys living in the villages or living in Gaza, I believe they know a life of fear. They have the choice of stay here, take the fire for us as a human shield, or we'll kill you. So they're dead. They're dead from that side or from that side, so they can't take our help. I would say this is a way of traumatizing by fear, like making someone afraid. If you won't do something like that, I'll kill you. I myself, I was never a believer of God. I'm kind of a man who likes to see whatever, if it's in front of my eyes, it's real. If it's not there, it's not real. Although I do believe there are some things that you can feel and that you can explain. That's what music proved to me. I go to visit like my parents maybe once, twice a day, depends on my mood. Just going there, cooking something, because that's what Israeli families are about. It's all about cooking.
Shalom!
It disappoints me very much that the world just see us as a terrible machine of death. That we're killers of children. The amounts of death threats I personally received as
as a guitar player of Orphanland, and the message we try to send out. I'm just getting Facebook messages, you're gonna die, or stuff like that. I don't know why people find the will to send a random person they never met. Whenever a war starts, I'm not afraid. I know there will be a next time. To cause a war over definition of land is, for me, childish. Childish definition to fight and to kill.
In the war, when Hamas sent rocket to Israel, all the cities around Gaza Strip, they cannot go out from our house, so we go there and play to the children, you know, like they was in the shelter like a mound. We are driving in the car to the you know, the Gaza Strip. Two rockets from your other side, so it was crazy. So and you know, it's like the boom, the noise is, you can imagine it. You think that all the people there, the children, you know, live under the, you know, the rocket attack. Crazy. I can see God on everything, you know. Here is God. We have the same God. We have the same God from Christians, we have the same God from Muslims, we have the same God from, you know, Judaism. So I don't know why they hate us, or we are hate them. I don't know, really don't know. I can't believe if someone believe in God want to kill someone else. Actually, it's a Greek instrument. The pop music in Israel, they use a lot of bouzouki. We play metal, we play heavy metal with full gain of distortion, with metal guitar, and we have a fucking metal drummer. And this is, you know, the difference is just the little bit of the oriental thing.
We are now in the Jaffa Flea Market, which is my favorite place to hang out and to look for stuff. When I have some free time, I always come here. I like vintage. The vintage stuff, from vinyls to the way I make coffee, it has more spirit in it, more soul. It's not, I don't know, it's not an iPhone, it's not a gadget. Brought us a lot of conveniency, but lost a lot of the magic and the charm that is in it.
לא, לא יכול, אין לי כסף, אני לא יכול לעמוד בפנים שלו. לא, פה זה לא ברכת הכהנים. אולי צד שני?
לא.
זה לא ברכה אנשים.
כן, זה לא.
One of the bad things about economy is the extra consuming that you are doing. You end up finding more stuff that you really need. I think the trick is sometimes to know to let go some of the stuff and to get rid of it and not to own everything. I own a phone. A cell phone, I own it because I have to. But there's nothing really emotional about it, like when I see that photo over here. Because that photo is a piece of history, it's a story, it's something you want to own because it reminds you, I don't know, three generations of a story, of your family, of a life. This is just a few meters from my home. This is where the building where my grandma, may she rest in peace, used to live. It's a very emotional place for me. And because it's three generations of my family. It's in here. the grandma from mother's side is just on the next building, and my kindergarten is also there. So I always wanted to live near these places because it's strongly in my heart, and Jaffa is in my heart. So this is where my mother grew up and where I grew up exactly. My parents are not from a religious background, even though they are Jewish, but when I was growing up here, I could always hear the mosque saying Allahu Akbar, and from the other side, in here, there is a kind of a synagogue where they teach Hebrew and Judaism. So I could hear where they sing from there. I could hear the Judaism and Islam all my life. I could hear the muezzin 5 times a day, and I could hear them where they sing their Jewish prayers. It was a part of the music, and since I'm musical, it was mixed in me together. There is a story that I'm very embarrassed to say, but when I was a teenager, I became extremist because I was stupid. It even came to a point where I did a graffiti one time, death to Arabs. I did it. I remember it was a terror attack where a Muslim guy killed a 14 years old girl. It was my breaking point because she was just a girl, and she was, from a school that I know some of her friends. And I remember we went to the funeral, and after the funeral, me and my friends, we wanted to find Arabs and we wanted to hit them. I was a teenager, and then I couldn't find them, so I did the graffiti. That was my, stupid revenge. And I grew up here with these people. So imagine the power of brainwash upon people who didn't grow up with them, who are just seeing the news, who are just having an opinion about Jews and Muslims without even meeting them. Every time I walk on this road, I remember the terror attack that happened by a suicide bomber right here. I think that a lot of people got killed by that terror attack. One of the people that got injured, it was a very good friend of mine. I wasn't here when it happened, but I remember she wasn't badly injured, but you could see even years after that she had a mentally trauma from that event. She was here. Every time I walk here, I think everyone that can walk here can be a suicide bomber. Could happen again. It brings these fears and moments into your mind. And there is a memorial place for the victims. I want to show it to you. This is the memorial place, right here. It was 13 victims. Among them, they were youth and children. It happened in 1996, in March 1996. Sometimes I cannot help it. I have these feelings. Sometimes I want to do it for people who kill children. I want to kill them slowly. But then I realize that I can turn into a monster like they are. But it's that moment where they take you down. And that's the most scary moment. Because you can think that you make justice while you become a monster like they are.
One, two, okay.
Determined that it is time to officially recognize Jerusalem as the capital of Israel.
I am ages away, far from understanding politicians. And politicians are the people that I maybe hate the most in this world. Who cares what is the capital? And this is games of politicians. It's stupid games. And they always play those games, and they always play with blood. They always trade blood, and they always play with those statements. Who cares? Of course, the refugees, the Palestinians, the Israelis, all of us are suffering because the whole world is like digging into these problems and making declarations, and they are on the TV. Who cares? I mean, everybody cares. I don't care.
People just take advance about our situation. They take a chance about it.
It's like this chaos, and you try to make an answer about a complete bullshit. You try to find logic in it. Doesn't make sense. So bad things will happen probably because of that. I really like Pink Floyd, and I really think that Roger Waters is one of the greatest musicians of our time. But I think that he is, and I'm always careful when I use it, I don't want to use it as a flag, but I think he is anti-Semite. Maybe he doesn't even admit it, maybe he doesn't even aware of it in his deeper emotions, subconscious inside. I think he is anti-Semite. He has something with the Jews, which is hidden. I don't know from where, and I don't know why. You're an artist, you're a writer. Why don't you write a song about it? Why don't you write a concept album about it? What do you mean boycott? Isn't artists should spread harmony in places of disharmony? Imagine that Bob Dylan would boycott the government of the USA instead of writing his songs like Masters of War. I mean, his songs were a movement of a whole generation. But instead of writing those songs, he would say, I boycott. Who invented that stupid thing that artists should boycott? Art is the greatest form to protest.
When he was a baby, when he used to cry, I used to sing to him. And when I used to play music, he used to be fascinated. He used to stop crying. He was very quiet, very modest, very shy, yes? The first time I saw him on stage, I couldn't believe this is my kid. I mean, I saw a different personality because he was so quiet and so modest that the personality that I see on stage is a different personality. The audience, the openness, the singer is a different personality.
Alter ego. When I was maybe 16 years old, I was a little bit radical in my opinions. And even though that we grew up in Jaffa and we knew Arab people, but there was the terror attack when a terrorist killed Elena Rapp in Bat Yam. You remember that?
Yes.
After that terror attack, we went to the funeral. Never told you that. We went to the funeral, and after the funeral, we were looking for Arabs to kick their ass. We couldn't find anyone. But after that, I took a graffiti, and with Zohar, remember Zohar?
Yes.
I did a graffiti, death to all Arabs.
Okay, I didn't know that, you know, in this age, they don't share the mother, the family. They are between themselves, and they're only social with their friends, and they are against the parents.
I never talked about it. Just recently I started to tell that I actually did a graffiti.
But I can say that he grew between Arabs all his life because he grew in Jaffa.
I don't hate. People are always people. Arabs, Jews, Muslims, Christians, all the same. People with different interests bring hate between us.
We eat here in this restaurant maybe 30 years.
30 years.
And he's working here 20 years?
20 years. תקשיב, להיות מוסלמי ורצה פה, קשה. הפוליטיקאים עושים את זה קשה, לא אנחנו באמת.
The politicians, they make it hard, not the people. The people, they get along and they are okay, but the politicians make it hard. For everyone.
כאילו אני מסדר איתם בסדר, זה, אז... כאילו, עם העם, אנחנו בסדר, אבל הפוליטיקאים, אם עושים את זה... לפעמים נקלעים בסיטואציה הזו, כאילו, אם אתה מוסלם וזה, אז מסתכלים עליך אחר.
נגיד בשדה תעופה.
כן, יכול, בשדה תעופה, בואו נגיד אם אתה נוסע לאלעל וזה. אם לא היית מוסלמי, לא, היינו משחררים אותך ישר. אם לא, צריכים לעשות לך בדיקה, וזה כמו שצריך. שיהיה מקל, כן, המוסלם זה טרוריסט.
Inside of Israel, there are 1.3 million maybe Arabs who are living here. If they all wanted to make chaos, you couldn't sit here and eat now. Most people, they live in peace. The Jewish people, they come to the Arab villages, they buy stuff from them, and there is a very good connection sometimes and coexistence, but minority. You need few idiots to destroy everything. And they always make the noise and get all the attention.
And Kobe is the politician.
If we are the leaders, we make peace.
אם אחד שהוא רוצה להרוס את העולם הזה, זה רק פה. תקשיב, אחד כמוהו, אם היה, תקשיב, זה קל מאוד לעשות שלום. אם הוא היה רוצה, אז תעביר את ה... את השגרירות לשם. בלי לדבר, בלי לקלל, בשביל מה לעשות כל המהומה הזו? אז הם מתכוונים לעשות את המהומה הזו, בשביל, אתה יודע, לעשות כל הבלגן הזה.
You want to do it?
Do it, but
what's all this ceremony and speech and party? We are big fans of Carcass. We've seen Carcass playing in Israel on the 90s. I mean, Uri brought here like maybe 10% of his vinyl collection of Carcass.
Less.
So yeah, it's good to be here. We just walked the other day on the street and we bumped into Jeff, just drinking a beer and having a good time.
Because to be honest, we've been asked to come in a few times in the last few years, but the trouble was, from my opinion, a bit worse than it is now, and I've always thought it's in poor taste when the real intifada was going on a few years back to be coming here when hospitals are getting bombed and stuff like that. But because it's a bit quieter now, I'm quite happy to come here. But then Trump, of course, fucks things up. Even if there were missiles falling, I mean, I've been into ridiculously stupid situations in South America, or we've been to Croatia when the civil war was on, so I'm not scared of dying, but it's fine, you know? We had the same shit in Northern Ireland in the UK, so, and that's not really... You can put, you know, a pressure cooker, you can put the lid on things and keep it, you know, controlled for a while, but the lid comes off. Just look at the Middle East in general. I mean, these arguments go back to biblical times.
I think you've been a little bit bashed on Facebook for coming to Israel, right? Yeah. All the BDS movement, they wrote to you, boycott Israel or stuff like that.
We like to piss off the right and the left, you know what I mean? So, I mean, was it Roger Waters who was...
Back in the UK, that guy, Ken Loach, the film director, he went to town on Radiohead about playing Israel, and they responded, I think, in the right way. They were saying, you know, we're making music here and we want to reach everybody. You know, we're not interested in those kind of barriers and whatever. And the other thing is, no one has a go at us for playing other countries with questionable...
We played Indonesia a couple of years back. That's like the world's biggest Muslim population.
It's the favorite subject for the left at home, I think, right now. And they're quite happy to overlook plenty of other things and just focus on this.
I mean, the reality is, Muslims are welcome at this concert tonight. Jews, Gentiles, Christians, just don't come in a burqa.
So we are now at the most explosive place on Earth, basically, right in front of the entrance of the most explosive place on the planet Earth. A place which is really sacred for Jews, for Muslims, for Christians, and everyone claims that it belongs to them. So these are the most dangerous stones on the planet, also the holiest probably, but it all starts and ends here. If a bomb explodes here, it could be easily a beginning of World War II, easily. And a religious war could start easily if something bad happened in the Western Wall or in that mosque. And they are so near each other. We will go now 20 meters. This is the mosque. The Western Wall is right there. This is the most sacred place for Jewish people. It's the holiest place for the Jewish nation and the Jewish people. Right behind it, it's the Temple Mount. So behind it, you can see the Golden Mosque and the Al-Aqsa Mosque. Imagine that this wall was just the surrounding wall, a piece of the surrounding wall of the ancient Jewish temple. Sure, it's a special place, even for me. You know, every time that an Israeli couple is getting married, the guy is breaking a glass, and he breaks the glass for the memory of the destruction of the Jewish temple. But if you ask me, what is more important? That wall or human life, it's human life, more important. The soul and the life and the blood are more important than the stones. And I'm saying it to both sides because both sides, they worship walls and stones, which I can sympathize. It's not just walls, it's a spiritual connection. It's not just a wall that I find on the floor. But if you have a spiritual connection to a wall, what is the spiritual connection to a human being? To a whole world inside of that human being, his dreams, his soul, everything. This is something that religious priests, rabbis, imams, politicians should put more into the brain of humanity. Otherwise, they commit a sin to the values of religion and stuff like that. So I have a mixed feeling when I'm here. I love this place. I don't love the problems caused because of this place. When I'm coming here, it's hard for me to breathe because of the tension, because of the failure to understand the true meaning. The true meaning of my hoodie's symbol, that one. It's like, that's the way that city should be. But then we take it to the ego, this is mine, my God is better than yours. Childish games of idiotic people with a lot of power in their hands. I think people are easy to being manipulated. It doesn't matter the intelligence or their IQ, and they are easy to be brainwashed because the people who do that, they are very clever. They know the human behavior. They know how to trick the people to do that. I will give you the easiest example. You can sell Coca-Cola with boobs. So they know that boobs gets your attention and then put a Coca-Cola near it and sell a Coca-Cola, sell a soap, sell everything. While the advertising world understand that, politicians also understand that they can brainwash us. We are way too far into it. It's in our food, it's in the way that they convince us that milk is healthy, it's in our medicines, it's in our newspapers, it's in our TV, it's in our education, it's everywhere. It's like a disease. You may ask yourself, why does technology is being so advanced and why humanity is just on a loop repeating the same mistakes again and again and again? Because we are trapped in this propaganda, and this propaganda is everywhere, from milk to politics. If I see a way out of it, it would be only an extreme change in the education system, and that means that you should take the leaders of Russia and USA and Germany and Israel and Japan and China and all those big countries like UK and France, and they should sit together and they should decide education is the most important thing for us, and we make this convention here and we decide that no one will be ever killed in war or anything like that. That's the way it should be, but it's like a fucking utopia, right? It's not gonna happen, but that's the way it should be. That's what they should do if we elect them. That's what they should deal with. That's what they should do. They should sit together and they should say, we are gonna work now that no more wars, that no more people will get killed, no more children will get killed. One child, one dead child is unacceptable. The world will not accept it anymore. Sounds like a funny joke, right? But that's the way it should be. I don't see a way out unless the right leaders will come in all those countries and together they will decide it. If it will happen in my lifetime, no, it will not. I mean, no one really knows how Jesus looked like. He was just a guy with a long hair and a beard, but people say I look like him, and I think it's good to use it for our messages and concepts. It's a joke that I say in every show. I'm always saying, guys, I look like him, I may act like him, but I'm not Jesus Christ because I'm not a virgin and I'm a big sinner.
Yeah, so we're here backstage getting ready for the show, as you see. That's our pre-show ritual where everyone is eating and then canceling the show.
That's all my mom's cooking, that's my mom right there.
This is our usual venue. Every year we come here and celebrate Hanukkah.
In a sold-out show.
In a sold-out show, yeah. It's usually our most special show, no matter where we go around the world. Very close to our fans and our culture in general. Hanukkah is... Alma Hanukkah.
They were the Romans and the...
No, not the Romans. The Greeks.
The Greeks, sorry. In the temple under siege, they only had a small can of oil, which lasted by miracle for 8 days to light up the whole temple. And this is the actual miracle of the holiday.
My parents are Orthodox Jews, very religious. So I grew up, it's actually very interesting, I grew up believing that we had to hate all Arabs and hate anyone who wasn't Jews. And then at around age 12, I left the whole Orthodox religious community, and now I meet all different Arabs, and all of a sudden, I see them, they're people. They're not what they taught me as a kid.
Sehr arrogant, wenn man als Europäer das Gefühl hat, eine Meinung über den Nahen Osten zu haben, ohne jemals hier gewesen zu sein. Das geht nicht. Man kann nicht Nachrichten lesen und meinen, man kann eine eigene Meinung haben. Also ja, man kann eine eigene Meinung haben, aber es ist sehr naiv, wenn man glaubt, es durchschaut zu haben, ohne jemals hier gewesen zu sein.
What happened right now with Trump? It's a great opportunity that
it's a little oil that might make a big fire and explosion in our place right now.
People, they want to feel like they belong. So people connect to some sort of religious or any sort of community, and if it makes them feel that they belong, they connect to it so much that they lose their minds. And in sometimes there's indoctrination, there's brainwash. I can tell you that personally. I've been brainwashed and indoctrinated. So it can cause a lot of violence.
I deeply believe that Offerland do the work of the world leaders much better than the leaders themselves. I think that musicians can make difference because music is a kind of above religion. One of the things that Offerland are proud of, that there are secular and religious people in their shows from every religion, from any religion, and everyone is welcome and everything.
I saw an interview with Kobe Farfi, and he said that, I've never been to an Orphaland show. He said that in Orphaland shows around the world, you see Muslims and Jews just sitting there and rocking it out, and I truly believe the real religion is music.
I feel that this is like my sparkle of light, my contribution, our contribution to the world, to give a little bit of light and comfort and good time. I am privileged to be a musician and to play for them, and I'm privileged to share this light with them.
Were able to come to Egypt and make a concert here, I sure would go to this concert, but the politics here make it difficult.
The main goal is to break stereotypes, to pass through prejudices.
My family konnte ich das ihnen gar nicht erzählen, dass ich aus einem Land wurde oder meine Lieblingsband kommt aus Israel. Sie werden das gar nicht akzeptieren.
Sometimes it's really, really difficult to get out of your community because of the pressure.
If it wasn't for Orphanland, my mind as a person would have never changed. I used to be a very judgmental person. I started loving everyone equally. Of course, a lot of people in the metal community stopped talking to me because I listened to this band. Some of them, they're like, oh my God, you will go to hell for listening to this band.
Tension is sadly good for the governments, good for the politicians, so they don't want to act dislike.
Politicians, they follow their agendas.
What I'm concerned about, for example, are some militias. They know that someone is listening to an Israeli or to a Jewish band. I would be concerned about people like, you know, groups like ISIS or groups like certain terrorist militias, because they are extremist groups, so they would find something like this, things like blasphemy, or they would consider someone who listened to this music as an infidel.
To say that music cannot change things, no. I think that would be really like trying to hide the sun with the finger.
Aber wir sind die neue Generation.
If we really be united, there will not be things to be afraid of.
I'm more optimistic that the newer generations, and with the use of technology and with the openness in the mindset, there's a lot of more closeness now between people.
This is what I'm telling most of the time to the students. Like, one thing is what you will hear Netanyahu saying about, or you will hear Hamas, or you will hear Fatah saying about, and the other is what the actual Israelis and Palestinians are saying about or singing about.
Yeah, I believe that everything that I was taught in school and in history was completely bullshit. What I really hope to happen, hopefully for some time in the future, for people to wake up. If they managed to make me feel at peace, and they made me change the opinion of so many people that I know, they can bring peace, of course.
They are able to sort of help people see that some of the borders are not real borders.
It's like the sailors when they are on a boat. They see the stars and they know that these stars will guide them. Probably they would never be able to reach them, but still they know that it's thanks to them that they can follow their path so they don't get lost on the sea. I think that we can see peace as that. Maybe it's unachievable, but it's there. Let's try it. Let's try to follow it. Let's try to catch it.